Hi, it's Bob Kraft of TennisMinistry.org, and just following up on a few of the pro players. This one is about Novak Djokovic, and for sure he's got the potential to be the number one player in the world. He's number two right now. When I first met him, which was at the Australian Open, he was with his family, his mother, his father, his younger brother, and probably a few other players or people that were family members that I didn't know. And he was very young. He was a teenager. Everybody was paying it very close attention because he had the game to beat the top players, and they recognized him as a special player. What was different about that particular time was that the family members and some of these friends were wearing shirts that would have his name on it, and like Adidas shirts, I think that was his sponsor, and they were criticizing the other players, you know, and saying he's the greatest and you're not the greatest. And it really offended the other singles players at the top, even people like Roger Federer. And the rumor that I heard was that they actually called him into the players' lounge, Novak, and they discussed it with him. They said, that's not what you should be doing. And from that moment on, things changed. But the next year, there was still that kind of element where his fan club, which are made up of his family members, were somewhat belittling other players, and or just saying, I'm the greatest, you know, I'm greater than you are. So it was a tough situation. Of course, he was young, he was very talented, but his attitude was a bit stinky, to say the least. So thankfully, he didn't have a lot of major issues with his with the way he acted on the tennis court. He didn't break his racket or cuss or throw things like that. And his younger brother, who was about 10 at that time, I went up. You know, it's always a bit of a stretch for me because these are people who come from another country. They speak a different language. Sometimes they don't speak much English. I can't remember if he spoke much English. It couldn't have been very much, probably. His younger brother I spoke with, and he was about 10, and I just asked him. I told him I was a pastor, and I introduced myself, and he was very happy to meet me because in those early stages, you know, he wasn't getting that much attention as far as the press goes. And once the press enters into it, sometimes they become so self-important that they don't talk, not easy to talk to the players. So he was happy to see me, and he said, yeah, I went to church, you know, when I was younger, but then I stopped. And I started playing tennis. And, you know, I was trying to find out a little bit about their spiritual background based upon this younger brother, you know, what they thought, whether they went to church. And he kind of gave me a little bit of a background. Now, the next time I really saw him was at a tournament in Sydney, maybe a year or two later. And I went and watched him. I was around, but again, there's the language barrier. And I went and watched him play a match in the stadium court. It was, I think it was the finals of the Sydney tournament, just before the Australian. And I watched his game, and he had the game. He hit the ball harder than anyone I'd ever seen play. Okay, he hit forehands, backhands, serves. Everything was extremely hard. But he couldn't keep it in the court. He'd hit it 3 feet out or a meter out. And so here he was in the finals, but he beat himself, basically. But at that point, I knew that this man could be number one in the world because of the power he had in his shots and the confidence. And so, you know, I always felt, well, you know, this could be a number one player. This was, Roger Federer was the top person at that time. Everybody said, no one will ever beat Roger Federer. He's the greatest in the history of the game. And I thought, well, maybe this Novak, I call him Joko. Joko could be the man. And there could also be another player, Andy Murray, okay, even though that's another discussion. And so, you know, in the last, it's now 2010, 2011, and 2009, 2010, with Novak, as I would see him and his brother. His brother's now a young man, you know, he's probably 17, 18, 19 years old. And there was a person who knew Novak and spoke his language from the same country, who I'm close to, and he actually came up and told me, he said, the family are Christians. And I said, oh, well, that's good to know. Okay, so this person helps me a lot with the ministry. He's not really on the tour, but he knows the play. He knows Novak for sure, and he gets around to the tournament sometimes. So that was very helpful to know. And then there's the aspect of the country he comes from is a war-torn country, Muslims versus Christians, unfortunately. And you know, there's elements about a person's life that we don't really know. Maybe they happened when they were very young, and that's probably one of the unknowns until he talks about it or he shares about it. You know, I do see. So I would go up to Novak, and you know, I would just I introduced myself, and I told him I'm a pastor and in the church, and he was happy to hear that. But we didn't really discuss it too much. I think it was just maturity issues. He was a young man, you know, 19, 20, 21 years old. But I did talk to him. But what happened was that one of the trainers on his team, or someone who's very close to, someone I've had contact with in the ministry for about 10 years, he's been receiving my daily verses. He's always come up and said, you know, I'm so happy that you give me support like this spiritually. He loves the Lord Christ. And, you know, so he grew up in the church. And he's now part of Novak's team. And you can see him always with Novak when he's, you know, practicing or when he's sitting in the lounge. And so that person has influence, and I would guess to say that probably he's told him, oh, this guy's all right, Bob's all right, you know, Pastor Bob's no problem. And one thing that I did notice without me, I mean, I pray a lot for Novak, but is that you would notice him doing the sign of the cross when he play matches, and he'd win a match or he'd lose a match. Now, I tried to pay close attention if he lost a match, how, if he did it, you know, because I want to see him give God the glory and the credit, whether you win or lose. It's really just about a part of your life, who you are as a person. And I'm not really sure if he does that at the end of matches, but for sure he was doing it at the U.S. Open, doing the sign of the cross. And that's a very public statement, giving Christ glory, because you only do the cross for Christ, Jesus Christ. And I don't know, you know, why he started doing that, or why he was doing it every match, or where he was motivated. I do know I've spoken to him. I do know he knows who I am, and I think in some ways I motivated him to go in that direction. But now, in 2011, he's playing matches, he's kind of looking up at his entourage, he's not doing the cross, and I'm not around enough to really be able to say much or to encourage him. I was with him at the Cincinnati tournament, at the Pilot Pen, I think I saw him there in Connecticut. I didn't get a chance to do the U.S. Open. But you know, part of it is just a learning, a process where you're around and you continue to feed people. Even if it's just baby spoonful of spiritual food, you just feed them and keep doing that. And, you know, it's my prayer that God will send the right person to him. It doesn't have to be me, or send me back, or whatever way it takes place, I don't know. But I do know that there needs to be encouragement, and that you can tell a lot by a person's action by how encouraged they are and how much encouragement they're receiving. So that's a great sign. We don't see players do the sign of the cross often. And I've been in the tennis game for 40 years, and actually I can only say I've seen two players do that, maybe three. So it doesn't happen very often, and we believe God will honor that if it's really from within his heart that he's doing that.